Namaste everyone. May I request Mohit ji to play Guru Vandana, please? Namaste and welcome to the lecture series on Life Divine. Respected Dr. Sharad Bhai Joshi ji, respected Vice Chancellor Dr. Parimal Vyas sir, respected Kevalya Bhai and all seekers of divine life. I welcome all of you on behalf of CLC Aurora University team and wish you very happy Navratri. This is also the auspicious time of Navratri Garba in Gujarat. If I take the liberty to explain the symbolic meaning of Garba is to live in the light which comes from within. The symbol of pot represents the body and the light coming out from pot is the light of true self. We will take the opportunity of starting a discourse on the life divine during the auspicious time of Navratri. These days should inspire us, motivate us to live the divine life. It is not necessary that an individual is motivated to move towards what is best suited for oneself. Throughout history, a vast majority of people were expected to work for a privileged class and unwillingly motivated to do so by coercion, manipulation, or brute pressure. In today's time, it is the pressure of surviving the day-to-day with the uncertain and precarious circumstances that face humanity. How then does the individual see the light come from within? In spite of being burdened by such artificialities and externalities, how do we achieve a life moved to divinity? Sri Aurobindo's seminal work, The Life Divine, is a work that is perhaps more relevant and critical than even before. Sri Aurobindo looks at the aspirations of both human and divine. The evolution of matter to the spirit in the universe is through an evolution of consciousness, culminating in the transformation of man from mental into supramental being. We will delve into the theory of evolutionary consciousness today with the initiation of the lecture series on Life Divine. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Professor Sharad Joshi ji. Let me give a little brief introduction because his work speaks a lot of Dr. Joshi. Dr. Joshi has held several prestigious positions. Few amongst them are, he was a pro vice chancellor, the Maharaja Sayaji Rao University of Baroda, advisor, public service examination selection, expert member, AICTE committee, etc. Having a teaching experience spanning 30 years, Dr. Joshi has contributed equally in the academic milieu by authoring several engineering books, articles, and guided research as well. Dr. Joshi is gifted with multifaceted personality. In spite of belonging to the techno-scientific world, he is also inclining towards spiritualism, is deeply influenced by Sri Aurobindo's philosophy. I welcome all of you to the path of divine life. I request all the participants to, if you have any question, please put in question and answer box. Later on, whenever we, time is available, I will request Dr. Joshi to respond those questions. I welcome Joshi, sir. Please
go ahead. Thank you very much. Welcome to this series of lectures on Life Divine. First of all, let me pay my homage at the feet of the Mother and Sri Aurobindo and invoke their presence so that their guidance may be available throughout these discourses. I also thank the authority of the Oro University to give me this opportunity to speak on Sri Aurobindo. To speak on Sri Aurobindo is always a sort of adoration. It is an adoration of the divine, and because it is their word. I am reminded of Nalinikant Gupta, who was a foremost disciple of Sri Aurobindo, and he said once that each word of Sri Aurobindo is replete with a spark of light. And to read Sri Aurobindo and imbibe those words into our consciousness lights our consciousness with his light, with his spark of knowledge. So it is an opportunity, or it is a happy situation that we have started this kind of a discourse on Life Divine. Sri Aurobindo has written several books, several literature. I mean, his complete works is available in more than 36 volumes. But his major works are about 5 to 6. And these he has serialized way back in 1914 to 1921, when he was running a monthly magazine called Arya. So he serialized all these works into this magazine, and then later on, in a book form, they were published. But Life Divine is a different story. His Life Divine, as well as Savitri, is a magnum opus, foremost elucidation of his vision, foremost elucidation of his vision and work for the future. And so it is a very monumental work that he has produced, the Life Divine. He revised the earlier draft of 1914 to 1921 in 30s and brought out in a book form in late 30s. When it was published, there was a review of this book of Life Divine in Times Literary Supplement, London. And I have projected it on my, July 8, 1914. The title of this review is The Prophet of Life Divine. He has said this here in the reviewer, of all modern Indian writers, Aurobindo, successively poet, critic, scholar, thinker, nationalist, humanist, is the most significant and perhaps the most interesting. Yet few have heard of him in England or America. This is a pity. He gave up everything and withdrew to Pondicherry to follow the new light that has been vouchsafed to him. What was his light? What was this light? To be of active help to the new world, which in his opinion was struggling to be born. To achieve this aim, he had first to make his body, mind, and spirit a delicate and precise instrument, and then to learn to draw from this instrument the maximum of its possibilities. Aurobindo cannot be dismissed as one who happens to have written a few fine books. He is a yogi, a completely free spirit, who writes as though he were standing among the stars with the constellations for his companions. So Sri Aurobindo, according to this reviewer, he stands very high in his consciousness and writes from there as if the constellations were moving around him as companions. Indeed, Aurobindo is accepted by contemporary India as not even Tagore was accepted. There are no criticisms, only praises. This rises to a crescendo of admiration. I want to point out another point about this review, and that is he has said the same thing as Nalinikant Gupta has said, that to read Life Divine, when you read Life Divine, there is a circle of peace generated around you. And that is the most important point that the review has made, that there is philosophy, there is high spirituality, there is everything is there. But the most important thing about Life Divine is that when you read it, you feel a circle of peace surrounded through you. And that is the most important, so to say, a tribute to such a book as Life Divine. So in short, what I'm trying to say is that even when it was reviewed in Times Literary Supplement in England, it was appreciated like a book which is of very high value. And that is why it is called magnum opus. When it was published, there was a disciple, Dara, in ashram. And he, you know, burst out into a hilarious mood and said, "Life Divine, Mother's Wine." Dara, as he was named by Sri Aurobindo, he was Dara Shiko in his previous birth in Hyderabad. And he came to, in this birth, he came to ashram, and Sri Aurobindo kept his name as Dara only. So that was his reaction when the Life Divine was published. Life Divine and Savitri, they are monumental works. Life Divine runs into 1,000 pages. This is a voluminous book. It is not about philosophy. Camilo has said several times that he is never was a philosopher. He wrote philosophy, that is another matter. What he wrote was directly from his observation, from his experiences, and not like Western philosophy, a dialectician, a dialectics of metaphysics or something like that. So that is what Life Divine is. It is a 1,000 pages, and you can say that it can give us a complete understanding of his vision, his experiences, his realizations, and so on. I would like to go into the outline of this life divine. Life Divine has 56 chapters, and they can be divided into several groups of chapters. The first group, the part one, is named or given a title by Sri Aurobindo as the omnipresent reality and the universe. So he is talking about here the omnipresent reality and the universe in its various aspects. These first part of Life Divine, which is about 28 chapters and runs into about 300 pages, can be grouped into three groups. First 8 chapters are a sort of introduction. And these chapters are the human aspiration, the two denials, and things like that, up to the 8th chapter, which is the methods of Vedantic knowledge. Method of Vedantic. So there he talks about how knowledge is obtained and things like that. So these 8 chapters are the introduction to Life Divine. Then the next last 3 chapters of this part one, sevenfold cord of being, ascending series of substance, and then sevenfold cord of being, and the last chapter 28. These are summary of this first part. Remaining chapters from 9 to 26, let us say, 27, 28, so 25, from 9 to 25, are a series of chapters where you can say that he is talking about involution, but not involution in the right perspective. You see, in our Puranas, it is said that this universe is consisting of several levels of consciousness. And these levels of consciousness they termed as Bhur, Bhuvah, Svaha, Mahaha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satyam. Actually, with the Gayatri Mantra, we are using three Vyahrutis. Bhuhu, Bhuvah, Svaha. Om Bhur, Bhuvah, Svaha, Tatsavitur, Varenyam, Bargo, Devasya, Dhimahi, Diyo, Yona, Prachodaya. So we are using only three Vyahrutis. And that signifies the material world, the vital world, and the mental world. And these three are the instrumental being of our personality, of our being. And therefore, what Vishwamitra's Gayatri Mantra says is that I meditate upon the auspicious light of the sun so that it can guide my intellect and these three levels so that my life can be divine, my life can turn to this light or this sun spark. So that is the three Vyahrutis. Above, there is a Satchidananda. So Satchidananda, there are three worlds, three levels of consciousness, Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Actually, there are four of them. Sat is existence. Consciousness is and force. Chit Shakti. Chit is knowledge, light, and Shakti is power, energy. So Sat is existence, Chit is consciousness, Shakti is force or this thing, and the delight. So these are the three Vyahrutis on above. So they are termed as Satyaloka, Tapoloka, and Janaloka. Janaloka means Anandaloka. So Bhuhu Bhuvaha Swaha, Janaha Tapaha Satyam. Janaha Tapaha Satyam are the three Vyahrutis on the upper level, highest level. On the lower level, you have Bhuhu Bhuvaha Swaha. In between, there is a Maharloka. So Bhur Bhuvaha Swaha, Mahaha, Janaha Tapaha Satyam. So there are three Vyahrutis above, which is of the highest world, Satchidananda. There are three Vyahrutis of the mind, vital, and the body, material world. And in between, there is a Maharloka. These Maharloka is termed in our Vedas and in our literature as Satyam, Rutam, Bruhat. And Sri Aurobindo calls it supermind because it is beyond mind. Now, one must understand that this arrangement is not Sri Aurobindo's arrangement. It is done in Puranas, it is done in Veda, it is done in Upanishad also. So these are the levels of consciousness, the universe, the omnipresent reality, and the universe. So the universe is consisting of all these levels of consciousness, and the divine, the supreme divine, involves itself from Sat. He comes down into the Chit, he comes down into the Ananda, he comes down into the Maharloka, he comes down into the mind, and then vital and the physical, and lapses into the unconscious. So this is the arrangement of consciousness, highest from the highest consciousness to the lowest consciousness below. This is divided in two parts. One is upper hemisphere and the lower hemisphere. The upper hemisphere is consisting of Mahaha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satyam. The upper hemisphere is consisting of Mahaha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satyam. That means Satyam, Rutam, Rohat, what Sri Aurobindo calls supermind. Then Janaloka, that means Anandaloka, the consciousness force, the world of consciousness and force, and the existence. The lower hemisphere is consisting of Bhuhu Bhuvaha Swaha. Now, when these two hemispheres join together, there is a layer which is called, Sri Aurobindo calls it overmind. This overmind is a layer which filters out the influx from the upper hemisphere and raises up as an aspiration from below to the higher level. But it is a filter. It is a kind of a borderline. If you have read this, when Mother announced after 29 February 1956 that the supermind has descended on Earth, she described the whole process, what she did in descending this supramental consciousness. She says that she was in the supramental world and she had a form as big as the universe, and she was holding a great golden hammer, and she struck it upon the door, and that door was a golden door, and that shattered into pieces, and the supramental light descended on the earth. In the Ishopanishad, the 15th mantra, Hiranmayena Patrena Satyasya Pihita Mukham Tattvam Bhushan Apavrunu Satya Dharmaya Dashtai, where the Rishi says that the face of the truth is covered by the golden lid. That golden lid is nothing else but the overmind. The face of truth is hidden by the golden light. And Tattvam Apavrunu, Tattvam Pushan Apavrunu, Hey Pushan, you remove this lid so that I can see the truth face to face. So that is how the Rishi of the Ishopanishad prays for the truth, to be seen truth, to have the darshan. So the mother, on 29th of February 1956, removed the lid, so that not only individually, but cosmic, on the earth, that force can descend and the evolution can go further. See, there are two kind of evolutions going on simultaneously. One is the individual evolution, and another is the evolution of the earth, or evolution of the milieu around us. So individual evolution is affected by different births, rebirths. So the soul grows from birth to birth and achieves this kind of achievement. But evolution in general is also from matter to vegetable kingdom to animal kingdom, from animal kingdom to human being. And from human being now, Sri Aurobindo says that it is bound to evolve into supramental. So these are two kinds of evolution. So these evolutions are affected by, now it is to accelerate the evolution on earth, general evolution on earth, that this supermind is descended, supermind is brought down on the earth, so that if there are aspirants, they can be helped to achieve that, and then the whole atmosphere of the earth can be changed, the earth can become divine. So this is the whole idea in Sri Aurobindo's yoga or Sri Aurobindo's vision. Now, these things, he has these levels of consciousness, he has described in these chapters, starting from 9 to 25. So the first chapter is existence. The first chapter is existence, and in that he is describing the Sataloka, or what are the points about Sata. So that is the existence, chapter number 9. And then there is another chapter, the consciousness. So Satyaloka and Tapoloka. So the consciousness he is describing in the next chapter. Then there are two chapters in which he describes the Anandaloka, the bliss. Conscious force, the pure existent, conscious force, delight of existence, the problem, the delight of existence, the solution. And then there are five chapters. In these five chapters, he describes the vision of supermind in five chapters, like the divine Maya, the supermind is created, the supreme truth consciousness, the triple status of supermind, and the divine soul. These are the five chapters in which he describes the Maharloka, his experiences and his visions and his observations about Maharloka, about the supermind. Then he, in a brief chapter, he says that mind as we know it is also a delegate of the supermind, but that delegate is in the mental level, and so mind has inherently a capacity to rise toward the supermind, but he has to, you know, it has to leave aside all the worldly arrangement and things like that, because it is a delegate of the supermind. The supermind descends into the division, the world of division, as mind. So the mind is in the world of division, mind is in the lower hemisphere. So that is the chapter he is describing there. And then on life, the mind, life, and the body. So on life, he has about five chapters. Life, death, desire, and incapacity, the ascent to life, the problem of life, the double soul in man. These are the chapters he describes on life. That is Bhuvarloka, or the world of vital world, and then matter. So matter is the Jada Tattva, or what you might call and the knot of matter, the whole knot that is you know hiding in itself, the Sachidananda or whatever. So that is the knot of matter, and then he describes, summarizes these things, ascending series of substance. See, when we say material world, matter is a substance. Similarly, when you go above, rise in this scale, the substance becomes subtilized. Substance becomes subtle, subtle and subtle and subtle. So pure existence is also a substance. So he says ascending series of substance. So substance is not only the material substance, but there is a vital substance, there is a mental substance, there is a supramental substance, there is a ananda substance and all that. So this is the series of substance that he is describing. And then the sevenfold cord of being. Sevenfold cord, what we have said, seven. Bhur, Bhuva, Svaha, Mahajana, Tapa, Satyam. All these things are around the Brahman himself has descended into this. So all these are his steps of descent. So it is Brahman only who is unfolding himself in this seven. So it is a being, the divine being, who has a sevenfold aspect of itself. So this is a sevenfold being. And then lastly, he talks about the overmind consciousness, the supermind, introduces the supermind consciousness and overmind Maya. This overmind is little different from supermind. It is very near to supermind, right? Because it is on the borderline. And just as you rise above this borderline, there is a supermind. But there is a little difference between supermind, not little difference, a fundamental difference between the supermind and the overmind. Overmind is a global consciousness. You have 1,000 aspects of world arising and merging into one consciousness. That is overmind consciousness. There is a verse, Yasmin Deva Adivishve Nishedhu. In the Veda, there is a sukta, or isme kaha gaya hai, ki the Brahman rises, and then at the overmind level, Adivishve, Adivishva, Vishwa ke upar, Adivishve Nishedhu, Devaha Adivishve Nishedhu. This is a world of gods. The major gods, Brahma, Vishnu, and Mahesh, and all the other gods, their consciousness is at this level. That is the overmind consciousness. The overmind consciousness is consisting of the existence of these gods. We will not go into right now into these gods and all those things, but it is enough to say that this overmental consciousness is consisting of gods. And up till now, up to the evolution of today, up till now, it were the gods who were ruling the world. Only after the descent of Superman, it is the supreme being, as the supreme God who has descended. And now he is looking after the evolution of earth and not through gods. Gods have done their work and now their work is over. And the highest supreme will now look after the evolution of earth and evolution of individual beings. So that is the first part of this, which is 300 pages. And it is easier to read these things. It is easier in the sense that compared to the other two parts, it is easier to read. The next part, the title that he has given is there is a general title. I have it here. Okay. Yeah. The general title is Knowledge and Ignorance, the Spiritual Evolution. That is book two. So he is talking about here knowledge and ignorance. What is the meaning of knowledge? What is the meaning of ignorance? And the spiritual evolution that is in the third part. Now, this book two is consisting of two parts, of 14 chapters each. And the first part is infinite consciousness and the ignorance. The infinite consciousness and the ignorance. What is the relationship between the ignorance and the infinite consciousness? How ignorance arises and things like that. And the next 14 chapters are the spiritual evolution. Second part. That is the spiritual evolution he is talking about. Now, in this first part of book two, that is first 14 chapters, infinite consciousness and the ignorance. Here, what he is talking about is he is taking stock of all the existing theories about Brahman, about spirituality, and then discusses them with respect to his own vision or his own philosophy or his own consciousness, his own realizations, let us say. So the first three chapters are general chapters, determinate, indeterminate, and cosmic determination and indeterminable. This is a little, so to say, philosophical or metaphysical book, metaphysical chapter. If you can go through it, it is easy to read, not that difficult, but the words are indeterminable and determinates and all those things. Then he is talking about the three duals. There is Supreme and his Maya. Then there is Ishvara and Shakti. And then there is Purusha and Prakriti. So Purusha and Prakriti is the energy of the Purusha, not in the Sankhya way. From Sri Aurobindo's point of view, Prakriti is the Shakti of the Purusha, but in Sankhya it is said in a different way, it is two opposite things. Universal level, okay, at the level of universe, it is the Shiva and Shakti. The universe is the universal God, and his Shakti is working in the universe. And then beyond the universe, in the Paratpar, in the transcendental consciousness, it is the Brahman and the Maya. This is not Shankaracharya's Maya, remember. This Maya, as it is said in the Gita, it is the Paraprakriti. It is a divine consciousness, but divine consciousness, divine energy. So there is a Supreme and his own Maya, his own. In Shvetashvata Upanishad, it is said, Devatma Shaktim Swagunair Nigudam, Devini Atma Shakti. The God has his own Putan, self energy, and that self energy is in Upanishad as well as in Veda, it is called Maya, not the illusion. We are not talking about illusion here. It is the power that descends and becomes a lower Prakriti. In the Gita, it is said, Bhumirapo Nalo Vayu Kammano Buddhirevacha Ahankareti Yami Binna Prakriti Rashtada Apareya Mitasvanyam Prakritim Vidhime Param Jiva Bhuta Mahabahu Yayadam Dharyate Jagat. So there is a Para Prakriti and there is a lower Prakriti, our physical Prakriti. This Prakriti comes from above. So this Prakriti is a divine power of the divine himself, and that he is describing there. Then he is philosophically describing what is the difference, God, nature, and nature, evolutionary. No. Divine and the undivine, the eternal and the individual, the cosmic. Now, these two chapters, cosmic illusion, mind, dream, and hallucination. Then the second chapter, the reality and the cosmic illusion. Here, Sri Aurobindo talks about Shankar philosophy. You see, historically, Gaudapadacharya, Shankara Shankaracharya's guru's guru, he wrote and commentary on the Mandukya Upanishad. And this Mandukya Upanishad is talking about Omkar with its fourfold, A, U, Ma, and Bindi Matra. Now there they classify A as a normal consciousness, then the U is as a sleep, the dream consciousness, and then the deep sleep consciousness as Ma, and then the supreme consciousness. So Brahman is divided into four parts. Now historically, Gaudapada Acharya has says that all these three are falling into the ignorance, that is part of illusion. And so only the supreme has to be attained. So that is how he formulated Ajatiwada, that this world has never existed. This world does not exist at all. We will not go into that. But Sri Aurobindo is contesting that. He says that the sleep consciousness, if what they are saying is that just as you awake from the dream consciousness and feel that dream consciousness is not real, similarly, this world is like a dream of the Brahman. So when you awake yourself into the knowledge, then you feel that this is dream consciousness, it is not real. This is how they correlate the Jagrata Chetana, Swapna Chetana, Sushupti Chetana, and Paratpara Chetana. Kermando says that these deeper consciousness, the dream consciousness, is not what you say. It has a different meaning completely. And that deep dream consciousness is like this. You see, we are aware of ourselves, of our own existence externally. So there is an external consciousness. And this external consciousness is having the mind, having the vital, and the body also. Okay? But this is not only our existence. We have Shat Chakras also. And these Shat Chakras are communicating to the inner mind, to the inner vital, and the inner physical. So the inner mind, inner vital, and inner physical is what the Mandukya Upanishad describes as a dream consciousness. And behind that, there is a sleep consciousness. That sleep consciousness, it is described as sleep because we are not aware of it. We are not aware of our divinity within, and that is why it is described as a sleep consciousness. But it is Esa Sarveshwara, Prabhavadhyaya Vibhutana Mandukya Upanishad says, it is the soul center of our divinity. It is the center of our divinity. That is the sleep consciousness. But we are not aware, and that is what is described as a sleep. Even you can say, in the universe also, as far as the, it is described that Narayana sleeps on the thousand-headed serpent, and he is his eyes are closed. So what does it mean? It means that even in the universe, the divine consciousness is working secretly, not openly. So that is the meaning of that. And that is why the sleep consciousness is not what you say, the sleep consciousness as such, but it is the divinity within you. And then there is a transcendent consciousness. Now, Sri Aurobindo discusses that and contests the theory of illusion, that what you call illusion is not an illusion. So mainly these two chapters are, you can say, commentary on the Mandukya Upanishad and Gaudapada Acharya and Shankaracharya's theory of Ajatiwada and Vivartavada. Shankaracharya modified this because we can always argue. You can ask Gaudapada Acharya, they're all right. The world does not exist. Well, the world has not come into existence. But then what about your food? How are you maintaining your body? Is that real or not? See, this is a spiritual experience. It has nothing to do with the world and things like that. When you go into the deep samadhi, your mind is completely at rest. And who observes the mind? Who observes the universe? It is mind. So if mind is asleep, you do not see the world. That is what he says. But that is in deep sleep. I mean, that is in deep samadhi. When you come back from the samadhi, you have to, take care of everything in the external world. And that is why Shankaracharya knew this. And that is why he said that as long as you live in the ignorance, it is also true. But when you go away from this ignorance, then you have paramartha. So he divided, he said that vivartavada. So that things are discussed in these two chapters of Life Divine. It is a monumental thing. And then next few chapters in the 14th, that 14th number is about ignorance. See, Sri Aurobindo says that, in our traditional understanding, ignorance is completely negation of knowledge. Right? But Sri Aurobindo says that if you say that you are ignorant, what does it mean? If you say that you are ignorant, what does it mean? It is the beginning of knowledge. So knowledge and ignorance are not completely opposite of each, completely contradictory. But ignorance is absence of knowledge or covering of knowledge. The knowledge is covered for some purpose. And when you cover the knowledge with some purpose, then it manifests itself as an ignorance. See, if you talk to a child, grandfather is talking to a child, what he will talk? He will say that I'm a prime minister and I'm so and so, and my knowledge is this. He will talk in his terms. That means he is hiding his own knowledge and talk and comes down to a level of a child. So in life also, when we want to say something, when we give some discourses or something, then only the knowledge comes out. Otherwise, we keep it in ourselves. We hide it in ourselves. But that is not ignorance, of course. But the point is that there can be an arrangement. There can be an arrangement of the Supreme. There can be an arrangement of the Supreme Consciousness, which can hide its knowledge for a purpose, and then that appears as an ignorance. So ignorance is not complete absence of knowledge. It is a hiding of knowledge. And therefore, it is always possible to gain back the knowledge. So knowledge and ignorance this is a fundamental question that he has raised, that ignorance is not simply completely contradictory to knowledge, but it is not, let us not say complementary, but say it is a hiding of knowledge. Then there is another thing. See, Brahman is an absolute. Absolute means he is above everything. He is Kaivalya. So he is he is above everything. He is not bound by his own laws. Neti neti and iti iti. We have in our shastras, they describe the Brahman as neti neti. But neti, what we say, he is not this, he is not this, he is not this. That does not mean that it is negative. It is positive. He is above this. He is above this. He is not this only. He is above this. He is above this. He is above this. So much so that we say that the Satchidananda consciousness or the Satchidananda also is our mental conception. And so we should go above it. Brahman is above it. Brahman is not bound by our own conceptions. And so he is above it. So we say that it is Tat. Or Upanishad goes into the other point that it is asadvaidamagrasi tato veshadajayata. In the beginning, there was non-existence and the existence came from it. What is asat? Katham asata sadjayata? How can existence come from non-existence? So what it says is that sat itself, existence itself is our conception, and Brahman can go above this conception. And therefore, it is described as asat. Asat vai demagrasi tado vai sadajayat. So that is the whole conception of our the absolute. Then Sri Aurobindo describes the evil and falsehood. Now this knowledge and evil and the treatment of knowledge and treatment of evil is in no philosophy. In the universe and the world, no philosophy can understand this. I mean, can say like this. Then how can evil? See, Sri Aurobindo's fundamental point is that if everything is Brahman, if everything is divine being, then whatever is in the world must have come from him only. The only thing is that you do not understand how it has come and why it has come, what is its purpose and all those things. But it must come from divine only. So if there is an evil, good and evil to exist, so evil must be also coming from the Brahman. Why it comes, to what point it is existing, what is its purpose, that is we have to find out. But it must come from the divine only. We must be able to resolve the evil into the good, into the ultimate divine being. So that is the philosophy that Sri Aurobindo has expressed in this chapter. So you can say that this first 14 chapters of the second book, is dealing with the knotty questions of philosophy, or knotty questions existing in the present day philosophy or present day spirituality or whatever you call it. So, in Shastras it is said that, you first present your own case, then you contest the other theories, and then again you try to summarize the whole thing into your theory. So this is the second book, first part, first 14 chapters can be said to be the part where he contests the other philosophies and interprets them in his own way, in his own theory. Now this third part is also more than 300 pages. So you can say that three parts, of course, there are only two books, but first 28 chapters, then next 14 chapters, and next 14 chapters. These are the three parts. They are almost equally distributed in terms of pages. First part, 28 chapters, is consisting about 300 pages, then 360 pages or something like that. And the last one is also about more than 300 pages. So it is running into 1,000 or 11 pages, depending upon the edition that you have. In the last part, he is taking up, among other things, theories of existence and all those things. He is taking up another point, and that is punarjanma. What is the necessity of punarjanma? What is the process of punarjanma? And what has these worlds that we have described, the Maharloka and Janaloka and Tapaloka and Anandaloka and all those worlds, what has that to do with the punarjanma? If you remember, Gita has said, "A Brahma Bhuvanan Loka Punaravartin Arjunam Mamupetyato Kaunteya Punarjanma Na Vidyate." So what he says is that if you do meritorious work, then after you leave the body, you are transported into that world, and you live for some time into that world, and then again come back, depending on what you want to do in the next life. So those are the worlds according to your merit, according to your stage of evolution, let us say, according to your stage of evolution. And whatever you have done in this world, in this life, you are transported into that world, and then you come back and take birth again so that you continue your progress of evolution. So that is in three chapters he has described this: punarjanma, the rebirth, and then the necessity of the rebirth, and the worlds and the rebirth. These are the three chapters he is describing. In the last six chapters is the future evolution. The future spiritual evolution he is talking about in this last six chapters. Rebirth, in the other words, that is all these three chapters, then man and evolution. This evolution, as I said, there are two kinds of evolution, individual evolution and the evolution of the whole world or old world. So it's to come, what is the relationship between man and the evolution that is going on here? Evolution of the spiritual man. Let me take this opportunity to say, see this, that when mind descends and it gets embodied, the first result of this evolution of mind in man is serving the day-to-day needs of the human being. Then later on, in the next part, when the mind becomes a little more mature and things like that, then he starts philosophizing religion, philosophy, and spirituality and all that. So whenever a new principle descends, it first familiarizes itself in the existing situation. And then it does its own work. It comes into own power and does its own work, like creation, mental creation, mental civilization and all that. Similarly, when spiritual power descends, it first spreads into few beings. So we have few yogis and few prophets and few these things, so that the earth is touched by spiritual powers. Right? But this is not enough. This is not enough. The whole humanity must become spiritual. Just like not all human beings have become intellectual. Similarly, not all human beings will become spiritual, but spiritual principle must be established, like mental principle that has been established on earth, so that its own civilization can be started, its own culture can be started. So whenever a new principle descends, it first familiarizes itself with the existing situation and then does its own work. Similarly, up till now, what spirituality has progressed on earth, on whatever earth, mostly in India, but that is only the first jhalak, the first principle of spirituality being established on earth. But that must spread, and just like a human being, an intellectual human being has emerged, similarly, the spiritual man, spiritual humanity must also emerge. That is what he is talking about in the evolution of the spiritual man. Then triple transformation is completely yogic. You see, we must understand here one thing, and that is...
Please.
Sri Aurobindo is talking about three kinds of things. And the one thing, the psychic transformation, the spiritual transformation, and the supramental transformation. Now, psychic being is a concept which is there in Upanishads. Gita does not talk about expressly of psychic being. It talks about in a hidden way, but it does not talk about psychic being expressly. In Sri Aurobindo's yoga, the evolution of psychic being, coming in the front of the psychic being, and psychic transformation is very important, very, very important, because we are talking about the transformation of the external being, transformation of the body, transformation of the external being. Now, who can take care of the descending light? Who can accept the descending light? There is only psychic being. So psychic being and its realization and its coming in front or its transformation is very important. See, in the Upanishad, it is described as Angushtamatra Purusho Indaratna Sadajana Namrada Yengishtra. So even in men, it is of a thumb, of a nature of thumb. That means a little part, little spark of it is existing. In Shrivindos Yoga, this staple transformation is, first transformation is psychic transformation. The mother has, you know, let us say for the first time in Indian spirituality, distinguished between the spirituality of the psychic and the spirituality of the higher levels. The mother says the psychic realization is boundless life, but the spiritual transformation or the spiritual consciousness means infinity. Similarly, you can say that you are living in the external, in a vastness of the soul. But when you say in the infinity and eternity, it is entirely different. So spiritual consciousness is consisting of the eternity, the infinity, whereas here it is boundlessness only. You feel that you are boundless, you are ever existing, but you are not eternal. So this is the difference between the psychic transformation and the spiritual transformation. Supramental transformation is a far off thing. He is not talking about in this triple transformation, but he is alluding that his third transformation is the supramental transformation. Then the next three chapters are ascent towards the supermind. How man can rise to the supermind and what its necessities. And the Gnostic being. This Gnostic being, in the Taittiriya Upanishad, Bhruguballi, he is describing about five levels: Annamaya Kosha, Pranamaya Kosha, Manomaya Kosha, Vijnanamaya Kosha, Anandamaya Kosha. It is divided into three bodies: the external body, the subtle body, and the causal body. The external body is the Annamaya Kosha. The Pranamaya Kosha and Manomaya Kosha is the subtle body. And Vijnanamaya Kosha and Anandamaya Kosha is the causal body. The meaning of the causal body is that it has not yet manifested on earth. Manifested in the external being. So when you say Vijnanamaya Kosha or Vijnanamaya Purusha, that Vijnanamaya Purusha is the Gnostic being. That Vijnanamaya Purusha is the supramental being. So that is the Gnostic being. And then he's in the last chapter, he's describing how the divine life will proceed on earth and how it will be realized and what are the precautions or what are the nuances of this supramental life. So this is how in the whole book, Sri Aurobindo is talking about the life divine. It is not divine life. That is an inversion. The life has to become divine. Secondly, in Savitri as well as in Life Divine, a line may be enough that what is life here is light above. What is life in the lower hemisphere, or you can say the master word of the lower hemisphere is life. The master word of the higher hemisphere is light. So life here must transform into light above. Or in the third or second canto of the second book of Savitri, the descent of life. The life has descended from above, and what was light above has descended here as a light. So ultimately, it has to go back to the light. So if now, with this kind of summary of Life Divine, if you have any questions or any clarification, you are all welcome.
So thank you so much. And I don't see any question because it's a beginning and it is not easy to ask the question also when we are learning. So initially, But I think the outline which you gave is gives the direction how deeply, you know, we have to go and learn from each chapter. Rather, every chapter which you explain that, you know, in a brief manner, creates curiosity and feel like that, you know, we have to really dive deeper to get actually what Sri Aurobindo talks in the Life Divine. Thank you so much, sir, that, you know, we are starting our journey with you.
We are offering our session to Sri Divine Mother and Sri Aurobindo.
Thank you so much. And thank you, Kevale Bhai, for being part of, you know, in the
My
starting.
My pleasure.
Thank you. Being part, you know, starting journey. We are starting, so your blessings are very, you know, needed. And thank you so much, all audience, to be part of our journey. We will meet on next Saturday, the same time. I wish that, you know, if you need any support for getting brief summary or brief idea before joining, we will provide you support. Please write on the same mail ID and or you know, connect with us. We will give you the number also to in a next mail so that you can be part of this journey together. Thank you so much being part of this journey. Thank you.
Both ending.